start, please welcome Dr. Gwen McMillion. A little bit about Dr. Gwen McMillion. She's an associate professor at Reading and Language Arts at Oakland University, and also a graduate from Michigan State University. Her work explores effective ways to think about the cultural wars between ways to think about the environment, different learning environments. In particular, she considers how the literacy skills the students gain in schools are related to the literacy skills they gain in extracurricular spaces. So, for example, like churches. And Dr. McMillion and her colleagues, like Dr. Patricia Edwards and Dr. Jennifer Turner, were the recipients of the 2011 Edwards Prize Books Award, Literacy Research Association, for their book entitled Change is Gonna Come, Transforming Literacy Education for African American Students. Please welcome her.
Thank you so much. I'm excited to be here. And you're such a wonderful group of people. There's just a warmness in the air. I might have to come work here. I don't know. I have to find my husband in church, though. He's a pastor. So today I'm here to talk to you about something that's very dear to my heart, crossing borders and building bridges between church and school learning environments for African American students. And so I want to immediately get started with my research question. This was my research question that was developed during my doctoral program, and I'm excited to talk to the doctoral students a little bit later about how all of that happened. But my question is, why are some African-American students successful in the African-American church environment, but considered at risk in their classrooms at school? This question was birthed from experiences as a child. My dad was a pastor. There's like a history of Black Baptist pastors in my family, my grandfather. And so my mother, who was my first Sunday school teacher, when I was in her class, I remember her asking the question every Sunday, so how was school for you this week? And there were a group of students who seemed to really always have a lot of problems. And I thought, even as a child, well, I don't want them to struggle. I'm not struggling. I wonder what's going on. So fast forward ahead, and later on in life, I saw this phenomenon again. And so I ended up at Michigan State University with this question. That's the short version of it. Now, when I talk about school and church, I have to look at the literature for both of those, both of those institutions. And when we look at schooling for African Americans, it's been very different. You know, schooling was not started for African American students. You know, it mainly began. I was just saying, I wanted you to be here. Hi, Ray. it was actually developed for white males. We all know that. If you know that, raise your hand. Okay, so. Anyway, nobody raised their hand, but that's the way it started. That's the way it started. So back in the 17th century, if we look back at African Americans trying to gain access to literacy, we realize that there was a struggle. It was okay to have your rightful place, but not equal status. So you could learn to read if you were going to do certain kinds of things for the master or other kinds of things like that, but definitely not equal status. Looking at the next, there was a century of continuous dehumanization, which was a time when some African Americans were trying to educate themselves, building schools and things like that. They were burned down. There were all kinds of things going on. And then 1869 through 1899, citizens on paper, but still very limited access to knowledge. It wasn't the same for African Americans and other people who were in school. And then even as late as the 20th century, African Americans continued to fight for literacy. And in the early 20th century, this famous quote, I'm sure you've probably heard of it before, by W.E.B. Du Bois, who is one of my favorite African American scholars, stated, "The problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line." Now this is in 1903. Isn't it amazing that even in 2016, we're still struggling? The African-American fight for literacy continues. Take a look at this. This came from Kids Count data. And if you look at, this is the United States data. If you look at African-Americans, still, this is fourth grade readers. The percentage of readers who were non-proficient. 82% in 2015. How is that possible that 82% of the fourth graders in the United States who are African American could not read at proficient level? Isn't that kind of ridiculous? Well, if you think that's bad, take a look at my state, Michigan. If you're African American, the worst place for you to raise your children is in Michigan. Worse than Mississippi, worse than Louisiana. I couldn't believe this when I first learned it, but this is amazing. And if you look from 2007 to 2015, even at other races, it's not really that great either. But for Michigan, 91% in 2015 could not read at proficient level. And the interesting thing about this is there's a state legislation, a law actually, that just came through March 23rd in Michigan that stated if you can't read at third grade level beginning in 2019, you'll be held back until you can. Imagine that. Moving right along, let's take a look at the African American church. Although school was not a welcoming place, the African American church was the first formal learning environment for African American children, and in fact, it was developed to meet the multifaceted needs of African Americans. It's the most influential institution in the African American community, and it's a place where parents value the knowledge there. We hear about parents not valuing knowledge so much in school, but the church is a place where knowledge is valued, and it's also a place where Black theology is learned and taught and perpetuated. Have you ever heard of Black theology? Let's talk about it. Black theology is one of my theoretical perspectives for all my studies. This is basically how I was raised. I told you that my dad was a pastor, my grandfather. So in the church environment, Black theology is something that's really perpetuated. It's also known as liberation theology. You may remember Jeremiah Wright when President Obama was initially running for president, and Jeremiah Wright had these negative things that were going across the screen. Everybody kind of remember that? Yeah. He was using Black theology. It was kind of set up so that people would think of it as a negative thing. But let me explain to you what Black theology is. It's all about fighting racism directly and explicitly, because the African American church was birthed out of political strife. So there is no separation between church and school and politics and all of that. In the Black church, people talk about what's best for African American people. And so politics sometimes get in there, other kinds of things, the important things like fighting racism, civil rights, Dr. Martin Luther King and all of the things that happened with that. That was started in African American church. Building Black resources is all about trying to make sure that people are successful. Now, I'm not trying to create this place where everything is wonderful. I'll talk to you about some of the negative impacts that occur. And one of them was what happened with Jeremiah Wright. But building Black resources as far as supporting and sharing cultural capital and all those kinds of things. And then finally, having faith and freedom. The important thing is that in the Black church, we actually believe that it is our, and I'm personalizing it because I'm a part of it. I'm very much an insider in this case. And we actually believe that it is our God-given calling. It is our God-given calling to make sure that the children around us are successful and that other people are successful. Do everybody do that? Absolutely not. But that's a part of Black theology. So that's what Black theology is all about, liberation theology. And we very much identify with the Jewish group in the Bible, very much. And I'll talk more about that momentarily. If you think about the struggle in the Bible, that's one of the reasons why African Americans identify with it in the same way. But I'm getting ahead of myself. So, theoretical perspectives that I use. I started out in a grad school just looking at sociocultural perspectives of learning and development, and we all know what that is. You know, learning takes place within a social context, and since then, I've been able to build on that. I've been able to build on that because over a period of time, of course, you learn other things. So I now call myself a critical race pedagogue. Reason being, I believe that there is, it's important for me to look at the prominence of racism in the work that I do. As I showed you, when I look back at schools, I recognize, well, no wonder it's not a friendly place for African Americans. It was never meant to be.
And so if things don't change, it never will be. It just makes sense, right? Importance of power dynamics, where there are a lot of power struggles, things that occur, mandates that come down, like the one I just shared with you. Well, if people aren't reading by third grade, if they're not reading, just hold them back. There's probably a reason why students are not reading, a 91% amount. I mean, that's pretty high. So importance of self-reflection and reflexivity. Just, you know, making sure that one always checks their motives for doing what they do. And that's so important in our research in general, to make sure we're not doing it just for fame and fortune, but actually to help someone. And that's, you know, my take on research. It doesn't have to be yours. Multimodal view of literacy. I thank Cindy for helping me add that part to my theoretical perspective. She invited me to participate in a project, and I learned more about multimodal views of literacy. It's something that had been out for a while, but we don't all know everything there is to know. So this expanded my view of what I was doing, and I'll share why. Visual, spatial, and gestural meanings, even while I'm talking to you, you're seeing me move my hands. It's a part of the way that I communicate and a part of the African-American culture. Not that it's the only, you know, other people share that, but I know you recognize that that's one of them. So anyway, let's move ahead. This is a series of studies that I've done on this topic, and I just wanted to share this with you. I didn't add the final one, which is a three-year study that I'm doing right now, a collaboration between church and community centers in the vicinity of our church. So we're doing some things on that. But these are the ones. There's the Joshua Preschool, you can read it. Couldn't get enough in that preschool setting. I needed to talk to some students who could articulate what they felt. So I did a study on high school students. They really helped me think more about the fictive kinship system and the importance of relationships in school and the difference between those at church and school. And so I decided to do another study with first grade students. I wanted to see, well, where does this all start? You know, people talk about that fourth grade syndrome. Well, by then people hate school. Where did that hate come from? Everybody shows up at school initially saying, I love school, I can't wait to go, I love my teacher, I want to learn how to read. And then by fourth grade, they're hating it, I don't get that. So I'll start with first grade to see if I can identify something. Well, the two first graders, Tony and Travis, were the best students in the class academically. They both decoded at a fifth grade reading level. Tony had been expelled from school, I should say suspended from school, 12 times when I showed up. And Travis had been suspended 15 times. How can a first grader be suspended 12 or 15 times? This is just like unbelievable. But we'll talk about why that happened. And then I wanted to go into this place called church. Yes, I'm a part of it, I'm an insider, but that actually makes it more difficult to study sometimes because I was going to bring all my subjective stuff in there. So I studied the children's church in several different churches and tried to be objective. When I wrote things up, I had one of my Jewish friends check it out. And she would say to me, it couldn't be that good. I think you need to look at this, you need to look at that. So we call it critical friends. And so I developed a group of people who would be critical friends with me. And then the six-year longitudinal study, I'm not from an education background. I was actually a stockbroker in my other life for 10 years at Maryland. Yeah, and so when I decided to stay home with my second child, I just, you know, all the things that I was doing with them, I just felt like a calling to go into education. I thought, man, I like this. I think I can help other people. And I thought back in what happened during my young, you know, age when I told you students weren't doing well. So I thought, okay, I'll be a teacher. So I decided I would go back and get my master's and become a high school teacher. But when I got there, other things happened. I ended up getting a master's of education in leadership because that was a transition between economics degree and going into education. And I was just sharing that one of my professors said, you know, you ask a lot of questions and I don't know the answer. You need to go get a PhD. Well, why would I do that? You know? And it was because I was asking questions about this phenomenon that I didn't understand. So that's how I ended up getting one. Anyway, I didn't teach. That was my point. Yes.
Does Tony Travis go to the same church or different church?
No, different churches. I studied different churches.
And not your own personal church.
No, different churches.
Tony attended a non-denominational church that was kind of like a mega church. And then Travis attended a Baptist church. So I was familiar with the churches, but they were
both black churches.
Yes, both predominantly black churches. And they were very successful in the church environment. People thought they were superstars, but at school. And actually, their teacher thought they were superstars. She just couldn't figure out what to do with them. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. But I didn't teach. That was my point. I was a broker, not a teacher. So I needed to go in school and find out what was going on. The opportunity presented itself for me to get funded for the 6-year longitudinal study. So I went in there to find out what was going on. I went in using grounded theory. I didn't say I knew anything. I wanted to find out what was going on. So that's my series of studies. And it's what I'm pulling all of this together from. So I'm sort of giving you like an overview of some of the things I've done. My conceptual framework was developed even in the Joshua study, my pilot study initially. These are the four areas that I find, even with the literature, it's illuminated when I study the African American church and African American students in school. Discourse patterns, ways of communicating or not communicating. Pedagogical issues such as mentor text, such as the way that teachers instruct students, various things like that. Social norms, where you see the little angel in the middle, you got a clown on the side, and then you got a baby there. So how do students do school? How do they act in school? And how does that impact learning? Is that impacting that 91% of students in Michigan who can't read at proficient level? I don't know. And then literacy network systems, I pulled from Cynthia Fordham, who talks about kinship fictive system and the importance of relationships within the African-American culture. And so I made up this term, literacy network system, because these are the facilitators of literacy in the church and school for African-American students. Well, let's find out what's going on here. The data collection, I'll let you view that really quickly. This is the part I moved through really fast because there was all kinds of data collected, and I analyzed it any way I needed to analyze it. So I don't consider myself a qualitative or quantitative researcher. I consider myself a researcher. So whatever it takes, I'll try it. Right? So these are some of the things that I did. Observations, interviews, samples, quantitative, pre and post surveys and tests. And I analyzed them in these ways. Discourse analysis, narrative, creating sociograms and matrices for the literacy network system, and of course the constant comparative method. I did a lot with that. The results, what's really going on? Well, I went in looking for sources of incongruence and possible points of connection because I wanted to find out why the students were not doing well in one environment and doing well in the other, but I also wanted to find ways to make something happened in both of those environments that would improve their learning. I didn't want to just identify problems. I wanted to also come up with solutions. So that's what I've tried to do. In the school, as you can see, discourse patterns, well, they were dissimilar. We all know that the majority of teachers in the United States are white, middle-class female. And so it makes sense that their primary discourse patterns as African-American children were different from the secondary discourse patterns that were occurring in school. That caused what I call cultural classroom dissonance. And at church, however, the language is reinforced that's not valued at school. Is that a good thing? I wonder. There's limited structure in the school setting, and I'll talk more about that and a lot more structured instruction in the church setting. There's limited repetition and memorization, two very important things that happen in the church environment. I wonder how that impacts learning. Many times students are unengaged with texts, but at church the text is engaging and students are motivated to apply. Well, we know, okay, we talk about the religion thing, that's going to have something to do with the psyche. Do we really expect school to look like church? No, but we do expect students to learn. So what can we pull out? Just want to keep reinforcing that. Discipline leads to academic exclusion. Yes.
All right. Can you give a couple examples of the texts from church?
I'm sorry, would you?
Can you give a couple examples of the texts
At church? Yes, I'm going to.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to. I know I can do it now, So I struggle, should I put this up first and give you, then spread it out, or should I give you the examples and then this? So I decided to share this with you first, in case I don't get to.
Unlike you, I need to get a PhD because I have a lot of questions.
Yes, I am going to share that with you though. And discipline leads to academic exclusion. I talk about that a lot in the Joshua article, where students, and you know what this looks like, you're in class, you're acting up, go face the wall, you're in timeout. In the church environment, it's a more inclusive kind of dynamic, where if you're acting up, I want you to stand here next to me, and I'm going to make you my helper today, because I need to keep my hand on you. That's a very different perspective, including someone and excluding them. And it tended to really stop some of the academic instruction that was occurring. Because if you're way over there and I'm not including you, then you're not going to get the same level of instruction that someone will get who's right here. And in the school setting, there was a lot of disconnection going on. With Tony and Travis, for example, I told you they read at a fifth grade reading level. Well, Tony tested for the magnet school, and his teacher would not sign the paper because she said, his behavior would get in the way. The literacy coach argued with her for months about this because she said the reason he was misbehaving is because the work was too easy. And his behavior was a result of that. But the teacher wouldn't sign, so he could not go to the magnet school. And that was her choice. Hey, discourse patterns at school. There were a lot of good things happening in school with discourse patterns. It wasn't all negative. Teachers provided cultural capital to their students through exposure to academic English. You know, if you are using academic English around someone, they can pick up on some of that. So that was a good thing. Some teachers understood their students' discourse patterns and scaffolded their language acquisition skills through revoicing methods, and I'm going to show you an example of that momentarily. And some students were able to code switch. Code switching is moving from your informal to your formal language. I'm sure you know that. So revoicing, what are we talking about, revoicing? Well, this is a way of teaching a student how to use academic English without telling them ain't is not a word. That's not proper English. You need to speak another way. Let's take a look. So Ms. Sayer said, boys and girls, what are antlers? Okay, Larissa. Larissa said, they little sticks up on his head. They look like little sticks on the moose's head. She revoices, very good, Larissa. And what are they used for? They grow big, Mark said. Yes, Mark, some antlers are very large. But what are they used for? I know, Miss Rudolph, waving his hand in the air. Tony says, they're used for protection. Well, that's not a surprise. This kid is reading in fifth grade. I thought, well, he could use those words. That's right, Tony. Antlers are used for protection. So in the environment at school, what we learned is it was a very risky place for many African-American students. And what she was able to do was take some of that risk out by not saying you're wrong, you're not making a mistake in what you're saying, I'm going to revoice and say it again for you so you can hear it a different way, without saying you're wrong. Some teachers don't agree with this stuff. Code switching, where here's Travis, here's our other first grader. Let's see what Travis has to say. So he's talking to his friends at the table, and he says, I ain't gonna say nothing else till I'm done with your spell. Miranda says, Mrs. Rudolph said, we gotta get done. We got gym today, I'm ready to be done. You almost done, ain't you? Uh-huh, almost, I got a question. Mrs. Rudolph, can I ask you something? Yes, Travis. I wrote a 2 in the tens place and a 3 in the ones place, which makes 23, right? That's right, Travis. Are you finished? Yes, I'm finished now. That was my last problem. Then he looks at Miranda and Tiffany. I'm done. I told y'all I'm ready to be done, and I'm done. Y'all slow. I'm ready to go to the gym. So when he talked to the teacher, he used the academic English. And when he talked to his friends, he said, I'm done, ready to go, I've got to go, whatever. So that's code switching. It's a really good example of Travis's vocabulary. Discourse patterns at school, on the other hand, often were a source of miscommunication. And the whole idea of direct versus indirect instruction and even demands. For example, there's a lot of research that talks about the white middle class way of speaking to children and the African American way of speaking with children. The white middle class way of speaking with children, say it's 6 o'clock, and mom might say, it's 6 o'clock, what should you be doing? And then the child would know what to do. Well, in my house, I wouldn't say, it's 6 o'clock, David, what should you be doing? I say, it's 6 o'clock, you better be ready for bed. See the difference? So if there's a source of communication like that, it's not always the case, but that's an example. If you think about that, if one child is accustomed to having someone say it a certain way and the teacher is saying it a different way, that could definitely be a source of miscommunication. Some teachers did not understand the importance of directly teaching informal versus formal talk, and they devalued students' language using standard English term. And you know, the standard English term, I've added that, Cindy and I have talked a lot about this. I like academic English. Standard English means they're substandard. And so if one is standard and I'm using a different kind, then mine must be less than if it's substandard. Academic English, well, we use academic English in certain settings. That makes sense to me. So that's the term that I use. Here's a teacher interview. I said some teachers didn't really recognize the importance of not doing that. Connie, a middle class lead English teacher, wonderful teacher in middle school. I feel it's my job to teach my students how to talk because they're accustomed to talking street language. I know that's how they talk at home, but I'm not allowing it in my classroom. I let them know that I expect them to use standard English when they're in my class. What's wrong with that? My class. My classroom. Street language. So her mentality is that the way that the child is talking is less than. It's not good enough. There's a better way. So Connie was not familiar with code switching and had never heard of academic English. She was part of my six-year study. I had to really work with her a lot. She came around after a while. Well, let's look at discourse patterns at church. Teachers and students utilize some similar communicative styles, and that makes sense. Hand gestures, nodding, affirmative grunts. You know, I keep listening for you to say amen. You know, I know you're not going to, but I'm just accustomed to that, that kind of thing. Emphasize voice inflection in Black vernacular English. The teacher talk register indicates strong language skills, and I'd like to share a couple examples of that with you momentarily. Also, there was this call and response kind of pattern that students become accustomed to in the church setting. Many African American speakers have that. So here's an example of teacher talk register. Now remember, teacher talk register is all about a student understanding teacher talk and then using that or mimicking that. So this is Tony's opening prayer when I studied him at church. Okay, everybody, let's prepare for prayer. Bow your heads, fold your hands, and close your eyes. When eyes were closed, thank you, God, for everything you've done for us, for the clothes on our back and the shoes on our feet. Amen. That seems like, what would I get out of that? Well, first of all, he knew that when you pray, everybody is supposed to prepare for it. That's what the teacher had taught. The stance for prayer is to bow your head, fold your hands, and close your eyes. He was simply repeating what the teacher had taught. So teacher talk register is about understanding the structure within something and then repeating that. It's like mimicking. So that's one of the reasons why structure is so important in the African-American church. Also, now, sources of incongruence. School teachers who refuse, this is important. When they refuse to allow students to use Black vernacular English in school, they reinforce an oppressive stance. There's power. Connie said, my classroom, I won't allow that street language in here. But isn't that devaluing someone if their language is not important? Because language is a very important part of culture. I'm trying to think of her name. I'll call her name in a minute. Cindy might be able to help me. But she talks about the oppressive way that it's not always that students don't know how to do it. They're resisting it. So I wonder how many of that 91% is resisting what's going on because they feel that oppressive stance. Did you have your hand up?
Sure.
Okay, come on. I don't mind at all.
Okay, no, it's, sorry.
Okay.
So I want to, Jen and I are actually talking about this over the weekend, and there's a, we both have a quote from James Baldwin, who writes about, it's not the language that's being despised, it's the experience, the child, or the experience.
And that's excellent.
Right, and I just wondered if, because I know you're focusing quite clearly on the language, I understand that, but are other things being indexed? It seems like, obviously, other experiences being indexed here.
Oh, absolutely.
Right, not in the child's life.
Absolutely. Right. You know, and the thing about it is, if I'm not talking well enough, I'm not going to talk. So, and if I don't talk, I can't really learn. You don't know even if I'm learning.
Right.
If you're going to keep correcting me, I'm going to dislike you. And if I don't have that relationship, so it connects.
Right. But yeah, I agree. Mm-hmm. It also seems, though, in addition, that the teacher is really, yes. So I can talk about the language as a teacher. I can talk about the language and the need for the child to speak standard English for success in the workplace, blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. Okay, that in a sense kind of removes it, at least at a superficial level, from what the teacher is really dealing with. I don't want to know about how you live outside of school, because that is also substandard.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Your family's substandard, mm-hmm. your actions, your culture, your so forth. So.
Yes. It's the mindset. And that's a really good point. You know, when we talk about language, it's directly connected to what you think. Eventually, it's going to come out of your mom, probably. So she was thinking that. And I challenged her on it. And she really, actually, she got so upset once that she started crying. She said, but I really love my students. I care about my students. I said, then you need to hear what we're trying to say. Let's talk about this
again. How long did it take you to develop that relationship with her?
Because at least like 4 years. Yeah. It's not something that's, it was a 6-year study. Right. And honestly, most of them shut down. Like the first 2 years was just about building relationships. Yeah. And then in that third year, they opened up a little bit. They were able to share some of their struggles because they didn't even know, they thought I was from the state. I mean,
from what?
From the state, education, you know, yeah. And because it was funded by a state grant. So they thought, oh, I'm there to find out about them and to tell on them. They knew me. This was my neighborhood. This was the school district that I attended. I don't know why they felt I was an outsider. But I had to go through this process over a period of time and build relationships. That's one of the hard things about working in that kind of setting. But yeah, so it took me like 3 years. The fourth year, we were really able to get something done. And then 5 and 6, we were on our way. But yes, and the other side of this though, is Sunday school teachers who use Black vernacular English. I mean, aren't they kind of reinforcing that language that's not valued in school? So I'm struggling with that being okay too. We have to think about that. Now, people at church don't necessarily like it when I talk that way, but we need to think about ways to build. So code switching is very important. That's the point here. And it reminds me of, I have to say this, UWYO talks about double consciousness. And so isn't it a great thing for people to be able to be successful in one environment and act and speak a certain way, and in another environment, they act and speak a certain way. So, you know, I have 5 sons, so I push them really hard. I would say, college brain on, that was our cue. And they knew it was about academic English. And then, you know, other times they couldn't talk like that all the time, or they would be rejected by family and church. Oh, they're talking white. So I know you've heard that term, acting white. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Shouldn't we be able to be very successful in all those environments? It's okay. Double consciousness. So the reason I was able to read those so well, the code switching and all of that, is because at certain times I speak exactly like that. And it's okay. This is the example I give my students. So it's the queuing system, and the pragmatic queuing system talks about different registers, right? So do any of you talk the same way in an interview that you talk when you're using pillow talk? Absolutely not, right? I hope not. Another example, would you go to a really nice restaurant and order a number 5 and supersize it? Same concept. In different environments, our students need to learn to speak different ways and to act the way that they need to act to be successful. Yes.
Curious as to whether or not some Black students have hard time code switching, and what prompted me to this question is that I did a small scale study, slightly different, but this reminds me of what I was conversing with Steve. So it was slightly different, but it was pre-service teacher here's perspective on people who speak different language or people who speak accented English. Mm-hmm. So what I found, and it was pretty overwhelmingly obvious, was that so when they hear people interacting in accented English that's like Australian or French, they would say, oh, I could trust them, you know, I feel so friendly to them, they feel so intelligent. One student even said, I had a professor with a British accent and I was so intimidated, blah, blah, blah. And then a large number of students said, well, I was walking down the street and there was a couple of students who were speaking in what sounds like some variation of Asian language, or they had a heavy Chinese accent and it was very unpleasant. I was happy to get out of their salon because they were speaking in Vietnamese or, you know, accented Vietnamese, whatever. So I'm thinking it's, again, slightly similar dynamic, I think, how, and these are teachers, and I think that perception will carry over to their pedagogical context.
Yes.
But, you know, for me, some people say that they could code switch to speak standard English or non-accented or standard English without accent. For me, I can't code switch. This is how I speak, and this is the accent I have, and I will always speak this way. Maybe the register might be different, but I can't quite switch to sound like Tim, for instance. So I wonder, again, it's different, getting rid of accent and speaking with accent and, you know, speaking different register, code switching. From vernacular to academic English is slightly different, but I do wonder whether or not some students have more difficult time code switching than others.
That's a very good point. You make me think about what I've been working on recently, and I've just been thinking a lot about this. I believe that African Americans should be taught English as a foreign language. And I'll let that sink in for a minute. And the reason is because Black vernacular English has a lot of forms from African languages. There's like a lot of leftover stuff. And there are many words that, well, I shouldn't say many, but there are some words that are not conjugated. And so they get repeated over and over. And I think it's largely because in some schools, grammar isn't taught. Now, I was never taught grammar, never. Isn't that amazing? I mean, when I think about it, so I had teachers who were supposed to teach it to me, but the schools were not really good. And so I never learned it. And so I believe that they should. Now, you said you couldn't. I wonder if it's your mindset. If you really try, it sounds like you're saying, I speak this way and I don't need to change and I'm not going to. Now, I could be wrong, but if that's the case, then that might be a block. Isn't that kind of the same thing that we're talking about, that some African-American students are resistant to doing it? If you really worked hard to speak like, what's your name?
Tim.
You could probably mimic him if you really worked hard to do it, but you may not see the need to do it.
You know, I never thought about it that way. You may be right. I mean, my parents immigrated to U.S. when I was 11, and I think my ex. So when I speak Korean, people say, where are you from? And when I speak English, people say, where are you from?
Yeah, you have this mixture. I mean, you sound pretty clear to me.
I don't speak any language like native.
But
I do have a colleague. I do have a colleague, not here, who's also Korean, and she's worked really, really hard to sound like native. He went to speech pathologist. And, you know, he said that he recorded himself talking, and I think he speaks pretty much like native, even though he came to the United States when he was older. So maybe you're right about
See how hard he worked?
Yes.
He recorded himself, he went to other, so, you know,
well,
it's,
I,
it depends.
I think that certainly, I mean, this is part of this notion of accents are as phonology, right? And there's a hard wiring where at some point in time, probably at age 13 or 14, yeah, I mean, it's sort of variation of chunks and stuff, but you can't. I mean, you have a certain phonology when you speak, mm-hmm. which you, it's just sort of hardwired. So mm-hmm. people who come from foreign countries who speak the English better than I do,
right,
and have lived here 50 years, will always sound like they're from German.
Right.
And this becomes the issues, say, with linguistic profiling. You know, John Bowles' work mm-hmm. in linguistic profiling, where he calls for jobs using, you know, he can sound like a white person, mm-hmm. and the job or is available or the apartment's available or whatever. Then he'll call back using, you know, an African American. That voice in the job.
And get a different response.
I think to make yourself sound neutral in some way, shape, or form is almost an impossibility.
Well, so it depends on the environment in a sense, because you reminded me that most of my money was made as a broker cold calling, and they did not know I was deaf. I'm talking to you this way now. When I was on the phone, they had no idea. And oftentimes when they came for an appointment, they would say, "I'm looking for Gwen McMillion."
Oh.
I am Gwen McMillion.
Oh.
And sometimes I would just say, "Oh, you didn't know I was black, did you?" And I was fine. You know, so yeah, you can code switch if you work hard at doing it. The importance of it, I think, in what you're saying is quite different than black children who are powerless in a classroom and being told that they can't talk well enough to, you know, communicate with the teacher. It's quite different. It's the power issue here. You guys are in academia. These are children who are somewhat helpless, you know, to communicate with their teacher. Did you have your name?
Yeah, so if I'm gonna be a teacher, then in the classroom, revoicing would be a technique I could use that would not be oppressive.
Absolutely. Did you see how that went? It was very smooth.
Yeah,
I do it even in my classes. You know, I don't want my students to think that I'm saying, you know, sometimes you have to say, well, no, you're way off. But you have to say it a certain way. And you can fill in the gap and help them feel comfortable speaking with you. Or you can smash them. Have you ever been smashed in a class where you just felt like, man, I'm not saying anything else today? Imagine feeling that way every day, all day. That's pretty, you know, that's... it's pretty intense. So yes, revoicing would be a technique that you could use. It's scaffolding the language experience. Yes.
Yeah, I love that she was talking about it. I was thinking about myself as well. Mm-hmm. Sometimes what I understand about Kishun is like, it's not even I cannot change, but the way how we are from our culture.
Yes.
Let's say I can respect. Mm-hmm. I can respect and be in that culture. But there's some sort of thing that it's like for my generation. I cannot, people can just say, hey, I'm American right now.
Yes, yes.
You know?
I just remember looking at you, the person's name is Bell Hooks. Mm-hmm. Bell Hooks talks about resistance and the whole language issue. So we can, if we value where we came from, you know, we hold on to that and that's okay. But if somebody devalues that and you don't have the power to push against it, you may just say, you know what? I'm not accepting what you're saying. I'm not going to listen to anything you're teaching. I don't like you. I just won't learn this year.
Just one more thing.
Mm-hmm, come on. I'm enjoying the conversation.
Accent issue can also play out in a very similar way with the power of a student. I have observed student, Asian student, often, I don't know all Asian languages, but often Asians have a hard time pronouncing L and R, and especially when they're together, like delivery, it can be very difficult. And I saw in high school, actually I was observing my student teaching a unit, and there was an ESL student, and she was trying to say delivery and became all very, very like that, because L and R are very difficult together. And the teacher, he was my student, and we had a conversation, but I think at the moment he was nervous, and it came across like, I don't know whether he really didn't understand or he wanted her to say it clearly, but kept on saying, what? After a while, she said.
I see that happening in my courses. We have an Asian cohort at Oakland,
And it just really bothers me when they talk and other students are looking at them like, I wish you would be quiet. And so I intentionally call on them and ask them and try to build them up, because it's, I don't know, it's the American culture thing. I won't go into that today, but that whole power issue, why are you here? You don't belong. All of that is a part of it. So I'm going to move quickly through pedagogical at school. The classrooms that use a more student-centered approach did not work as well. I talked to you about structure. You know, the structure for the prayer. There's structure in church. Things are repetitive. Limited repetition and memorization, it's considered ineffective to most school teachers. They don't do that. You don't need to memorize things. You know, let's just go through the process. Teachers had higher academic expectations for students with parental support, and they thrived academically. Well, that makes sense. That's nothing new, right? That's old stuff. But in classrooms that had limited books, okay, this is that literature issue, students were looking through windows at other people's lives rather than at mirrors that reflected their own life situation, their own faces. And that's Bishop's work from way back. You know, we need to have literature in the classrooms that are mirrors and windows, not all windows. I grew up on Fun with Dick and James. I mean, really? Nobody in my neighborhood looked like that. Nobody in my house. Superficial use of text, you know, very unengaging. I work with my students on this a lot. You know, even read alouds, just a very monotonous kind of, you know, I don't know. Anyway, some teachers attempted to expose students to culturally responsive text, and that's a good thing. So that was at school. Now, at church, I want to emphasize that, because I'm making the assumption, and maybe I shouldn't, that you don't go to black churches every Sunday. Some of you may, so let me talk a little bit about this. There's structure. So during classes and activities, there's always a song, scripture, prayer, lesson, activity. A song, scripture, prayer, sermon, invitation. If there's a rehearsal, if there's a whatever's going on, there's always a song, scripture, prayer. So the point is structure. And when that structure is there, a student doesn't have to spend a part of their mental faculty wondering what's going to happen. They know this is how it's going to happen, so I can focus on what's happening here, and then I know what's coming next. Repetition, practice makes perfect. That's huge. If you think about many of the artists and famous people, most of them came out of the black church, the African American, and they learned practice makes perfect. So we do it over and over and over and over again. When it's not happening in the school, could African American students be thinking, maybe this isn't important because we're not repeating it? I wonder. Memorization helps one internalize information. And Cindy just told me I have 2 minutes, so I'm going to answer your question that you asked a minute ago about the mentor text. So the mentor text in church, in most churches, the Holy Bible. In the black church, however, Lauren Sykes' expressive engagement helped me a lot to think about what happens when the Bible stories are read. There's the dramatizing where there's skits and things like that. Inserting, I mentioned to you that African Americans identify with the Jewish experience. And there's research that talks about that. I mean, you know, you'll hear the analogy occur a lot of times, just like the children of Israel. You know, we were enslaved and all those kinds of things. So it's a different kind of relationship that African American people may have to the Bible. And then applying is huge. You know, it's application. It's not just about reading it. But during all of those learning experiences, children are required to think about how to apply what's going on, which is a higher order thinking skill, right? So when they go to school and somebody says, oh, you little dummy, they don't say it like that, but treating one as such, you can't really comprehend this stuff. And could it be the way that it's presented or the low expectations? You know, there's the old article about the ghetto education. What is it? Self-fulfilling prophecy of the ghetto education. If you haven't read that, you need to read that, because it's the low expectations maybe that occur. Moving really quickly, so I talked about social norms and the academic exclusion that occurs, social norms at school and how students are often pulled in. I want to just hit this just a second, because the literacy network system at church and at school, there's all this teacher blaming and bashing, and it's not always African Americans who are doing it. look at those scores. Now who's going to be held accountable? So teachers are getting frustrated about that kind of thing. There's the knowledge and language barrier. And also teachers, administrators, and support staff disagree on a lot of important issues. In the church, there are these cross-generational relationships. And so in my six-year longitudinal study, I'm going to end with this. It was so exciting because we had grandmothers who are a part of it. Once we figured out things weren't working at school, we called some grandmothers in. Now, these grandmothers were from the community. Many of them were from the church. And we were working on a science project. Parents were not answering the phone. They weren't coming in. They weren't bringing their things. We called Grandma Mary, and we called Grandma Connor. 2 weeks later, the whole school was filled with parents because they would call them and talk a different language. They had a relationship from way back. They knew them. So sometimes we can't always do it ourselves in the school. We have to reach out to others. That's all a part of this fictive kinship system as well. You know, bringing in the community, bringing in the coaches, bringing in the pastors to make them a part of the team so that we can make sure that students are successful. And so Cindy's looking at me like, you better stop right now. So these are the shared domains of literacy. I didn't only look at sources of incongruence, but there's also a chapter on shared domains. So there are some similarities, and these are the areas that we're working within right now to try to build on the things that are similar and work on the things that are different. So what? This is our Michigan State question, right? Whatever we do there, the question was always asked, so what? Well, a teacher's job is always to bridge from the old to the new because there really is no other choice. Kids are who they are. They bring what they bring. They know what they know. Our job is not to wish the students knew more or knew differently. Our job is to turn each student's knowledge, along with diversity of knowledge we will encounter in a classroom of learners, into a curricular strength rather than an instructional inconvenience. And I'll stop with P. David's statement.